Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
With minds joined in that one clear intention to cut through deception, to uncover false beliefs, we come together again.
Yes.
Let's begin by talking about the illusion of sickness.
The illusion of sickness. Well, we can run it through our metaphysics real quick so we can get our basis for our discussion, because really it all comes back to the basic metaphysics. So let's take it first from the tiny mad idea that it's possible to be separate from God. And the mind, instead of remembering to laugh at such a silly idea, taking it serious and feeling horrified that it has pulled off the impossible, that is actually separated from God, and a world being projected out to hide from God. And the world as a defense, as a screen. So we already talked about yesterday how it was very important to see differences, to see a split out there on the screen, as opposed to seeing the split in the mind, because the deceived mind is terrified of the light, and it wants to run, so to speak, onto the screen and be distracted, and the ego would have the mind remain distracted with the screen. And to see victims, victimizers, good guys, bad guys, fortunate, unfortunate, to see the split on the screen is very important. And part of the split that we really didn't go into a great depth about was sickness and health. That, once again, we have a spectrum of what this world would call sick, certain symptoms in which the body seems to be breaking down, or seems to be operating at less than what it would call the norm. And the other extreme is health, which is once again an illusion, in the sense that there are certain standards and norms of the physique, of the immune system, that are thought to be a part of a healthy body. And so we have a spectrum there, another split and duality of sickness and health. And when in reality, if we pull it back, that in a sense the body is not sick and the body is not well. These are meanings that are read onto the screen and onto the body, and the mind then determines what it thinks health is and what it thinks sickness is.
So it's really just the mind's interpretation of what is seen through the body's eyes.
Yes. The body's eyes are continually bringing forth witnesses. I mean, they were made to call forth witnesses of separation. And basically, it's the separating out and the categorizing activities of the mind where the judgment takes place. That basically, the body's senses just bring forth witnesses to fill in the categories and the splits and the judgments that have already been made in the mind. So in other words, the deceived mind has a category of what it calls sickness, and it will call forth, it will look for witnesses to that category. Oh, you're looking a little tired today, you look a little run down, you're a little bit pale, you don't look very well. Obviously things such as blood, sores, scabs,
coughs, sneezes,
loss of limbs, you know, injuries, so forth. Those are all in the sickness category. Generally, pain is, in one's experience, is categorized in the area of sickness as well. So that this includes feelings in the body as well, whereas the body may not look sick according to a certain category, if one is feeling pain, there's usually an association with illness or sickness. And once again, this is a witness. This is a decision in mind that's being projected onto the body as a witness. The mind then has a quick forgetting. It forgets that it had made the decision, and it seems as if all things in the world, as if something in the world, germs or I burn myself on a stove, as if the stove, the hot stove and the finger touching it has been the cause of the throbbing pain in the finger, or I sprained my ankle, or, you know, there's always a justification for the pain. It's being seen as happening with something in the world. And once again, what is forgotten is that it's a decision in the mind, that the mind is afraid of love, the mind is afraid of healing in that sense, because healing would in a sense prove to the deceived mind the fallacy of its guilt and the fallacy of its deception, and the deceived mind is convinced that it's guilty. So in a real twisted way, it's like healing would prove God right and me wrong. And in a sense, to the deceived mind or to the ego, it's like God wins then. If I'm healed, then God wins. And the mind is so convinced of its guilt, so convinced of its that it has usurped the power of God, that it recoils from love, it recoils from light. When light gets too close, you know, there's too close of an awareness of it, then a defense such as sickness is a quick way of providing a witness, forgetting that the mind made the witness, and justifying its unworthiness and guilt.
So is another way of talking about that just to put it in the framework of littleness and magnitude, and the mind that believes it's separated from God then believes that it's guilty, that it's going to be punished, believes in its littleness.
Mm-hmm.
And the sickness that it projects is then proof that, you know, it's like saying to God, see, I am little. Mm-hmm. I am weak, I am nothing, I am puny, I am helpless, I am frail. I am not the magnitude that you think I am.
Yes.
Or that you created me to be. I've made myself something else other than that.
Mm-hmm. Yes, and certainly sickness conflicts with the idea of magnitude. Mm-hmm. It's impossible to hold the idea in mind that I am the Holy Son of God Himself, or that I am infinite, that I am spirit, with the witness of pain, of deterioration, of sickness, being identified with the body as being sick and so forth. So it definitely wipes out of awareness the thought of magnitude, which is precisely why it's used. It's
the ego's intention is to keep that magnitude out of mind.
Mm-hmm.
And anything is limiting is sickness. Certainly does that.
Mm-hmm. And also, when we get back to that, to the levels, the mind and the world-body level, once again we have level confusion, in the sense that sickness as seen in the world, or health as seen in the world, we get into defining the problem based on form. And we discussed yesterday that the problem is in the mind. And when the problem is seen to be in the mind, when the problem is seen to be solely the belief in separation, then it's answered, because the solution or the Holy Spirit is in the mind. But when the problem is not seen where it is, when the problem is defined as being in the world, then, of course, the solution is obscure, because the problem is still not defined correctly, and so the problem is obscure. So as we see with defining sickness as being out in the world and in the body, that once again conveniently serves the ego, because it denies or covers over the fact that the mind is sick. Because the focus is on, I've got a sick body, I've got the flu, I've got cancer, sore throat, or so forth, and this is my problem, this is the way the problem has been defined. And the flip side, of course, is, you know, I'm in great shape. I can bench press 400 pounds, and I can jog, you know, 20 miles without hardly breaking a sweat. I've got great stamina.
My cholesterol counts
way down, you know, trim, lean, mean, fight machine, you know, the whole deal. This is the mind's definition of health. And there's a great obsession to pursue that as well.
You're saying either one, both are equally illusory.
Yes, because there is no health in the world per se, because health is
a state of mind.
State of mind is peace of mind.
It's not a state of body.
Yes.
And of course, we associate health and sickness with a state of body.
Yes.
And it's really a state of mind.
Yes.
But it's because of that association with the body that it is an effective decoy or delay maneuver by the ego to keep the mind from looking at the mind.
Yes. Okay. Health is associated with nutrition as well. Mm-hmm. I mean, eating the right foods. The laws of nutrition, as we learn in Lesson 76 of the Course in Miracles, tells us that that's a made-up law. Obviously, it has to do with the body. And that's just another one of the, you know, economics and so on and so forth that are made-up laws that have nothing to do with peace of mind, that have nothing to do with the eternal laws.
It seems to have something to do with what's defined by the ego dictionary as health of the body because of the mind's investment in it.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
You know, so you can believe that, you know, an exercise program and a very conscientious nutrition program can result in a healthy body.
Mm-hmm.
And it may result in a healthy body by that definition of healthy body. But even that is only a result of the exercise program and the nutrition program because of the mind's belief and investment in it. Is that right?
There can be an apparent change, but the mind is judging health according to its standards.
Mm-hmm. So it's still an interpretation. Obviously.
It's still an interpretation. The deceived mind has a big investment in the body, of course, because it has within the dream world, it has turned its back on the light. It has foregone and dissociated the spirit that it truly is, and it believes it is a body, or at least in a body. And therefore, health is important. I mean, it now has chosen the body to focus on as its home. And it focuses on it as if it's born in a body, and if it lives a certain while, and if it will die. But it wants to make the body the best home that it can make for it, in a sense. Despite the fact that the body will break down and degenerate and will never be immortal, and is very temporal and transitory, just like everything else in the projected cosmos, the mind is a big investment in trying to make it a good home. Therefore, if it's seen as I can make it live longer by exercising and eating the right things, if I can make it more comfortable by doing these things, then I'll do it. But still the flip side is that there's a strong identification and belief in the body. The body in this perspective is not seen as nothing. It is seen as something. And that's why the obsession for, or the great search for health in the wrong place. Once again, health can accurately be described as inner peace, as a mind that has let go of judgment, that has let go of ordering thoughts that we talked about, a mind that reaches a true perception or a more stabilized perception is a mind at peace and a mind that truly is healed, and truly, in that sense of the word, is healthy.
So even to consider the body as an instrument that the Holy Spirit uses